Banshees were the face of disco that was taking over the world. They were selling more records than any other act on the planet.
Their career started in the mid-60s. You're talking the best part of 40 years. Incredible songwriters.
They were the first group to have a UK number one in the 60s, the 70s and the 80s. That in itself is testament to their lasting relevance as musicians. How deep is your love?
They have won so many songwriting awards. And, you know, of course, when you include the songs they've written for other people as well, it's just an amazing back catalogue of work.
Bono of U2 says that he listens to the Bee Gees back catalogue and he is, quote, sick with envy. And people who know about music and know about songs know how great the Bee Gees were. They were three stroppy brothers who conquered the world.
The Gibb brothers had a really interesting upbringing. They were actually born in the Isle of Man and then moved to Manchester for the childhood.
There was always music in the Gibb household. Their father, Hugh, was a drummer in a big band, and he met their mother, Barbara, who was a big band singer. And they played around at the clubs and pubs of Manchester.
Not just the three brothers from the group, but also their youngest brother as well grew up to become a musician, so it was obviously a big influence in their household. It's just a
Barry, the oldest, and the twins, Robin and Morris, had already started singing at school. And really unusually for the times, remember this was pre-Beatles, they were actually writing their own material. And by the time the nine-year-old twins and Barry, who was slightly older, moved to Australia, they were firmly established as a performing group. We play high, I play.
In August 1958, the Gibb family emigrated to Queensland, Australia. The young brothers performed to raise pocket money and began work at a speedway track. Hey boy, it ain't no good
in doing what... When they were in Australia, it's just still as really small boys, the Gibb brothers started playing at a speedway track just to make some extra money. And it was there that they got introduced to a radio DJ who kind of took them under his wing a bit and helped them kind of create the band that then was to become the Bee Gees.
They hooked up with some guys called Bill Good and Bill Gates, which is actually where the group gets the name the Bee Gees, because obviously Barry Gibb as well, it seemed like too good an opportunity to miss, and it came to be known to mean the Brothers Gibb later on. But that's when they first started working.
Barry, the leader of the group, come here. Barry Gibb and your young brothers. Now, come on, who are you? Which is which? Your twins, eh?
I'm Robin.
Robin?
Morris.
And Morris. Now, you all sing together, eh?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And your brother, Barry, plays. Now, come on up. Come on up here. Sing on, this time
is passing by. Bill Gates was dazzled by their harmonies and their songwriting skills. And although Hugh, the father, was the manager, Bill Gates acted as a kind of agent and a sort of unpaid publicist for them.
I imagine it must have been a novelty to an extent. You've got three teenage boys, all brothers, writing their own material. Mancunians transplanted to Australia. So I'd imagine that it's, you know, it's perfect TV material.
The notion of these children writing their own songs was almost unheard of. So of course they got airplay. Their songs were covered by American acts such as Wayne Newton, and eventually they became quite famous. Where is the sun that shone on
my head? The sun in my head. Their exposure and appeal as young songwriters secured the Bee Gees their first record deal in 1963 with Festival Records. Over the next few years, the band used studio time to greatly improve their skills, and in 1966, after transferring to Spin Records, secured their first major hit, Spicks and Specks. Where are the girls that left far behind?
street and the space. I'm the girl of my mind.
Their first big hit in Australia for the Bee Gees was Spicks and Specks, and it's very of its time, it's kind of rock and roll-y, and it sounds quite different to what you think of when you think of the Bee Gees now.
It sounds like a Beatles track, really. The fact that it's written by them at such a young age makes it even more intriguing. For people who are aware of later Bee Gees, it actually sounds very different and very 60s poppy.
Even now, this is a pretty fantastic song. It's got this brilliant melody, there's military drumming in it, and then at the end, there's a brass section. It's very much, shall we say, of its time.
I guess it was very relevant to that point, and for them in Australia, it was quite a big hit. All of my
life, it was a real signpost for them, songwriting-wise, and it showed that maybe this was an act who could make it beyond Australia.
Australia's most influential music newspaper, Go Set, awarded Spicks and Specks the best single of the year in 1967. However, the Gibbs brothers had already decided to return to England and hoped to further their success in a thriving music scene.
I think the Bee Gees moved back to England around about the time that Barry Gibb was in his early 20s because they were a bit frustrated with the kind of music scene in Australia and not getting as much recognition as they thought they deserved.
Everything's happening in the UK and the US. At this point, they'd had some minor success in Australia and I think looked at the success of the Beatles and thought, I want to be part of that.
This is 67, this is swing 60s. Everything was going on there. And what's more, I think this is very significant, the Beatles were recording, but they weren't playing live. 67 was Sgt. Pepper. And so there's a gap in the market there for a harmonising, melodic band.
They moved back to England for one simple reason, pure ambition. Before they sailed for Britain, they'd sent a letter to the Beatles manager, Brian Epstein, to tell him that they were on their way. They left the ship at Southampton. They moved that very day to a flat in Hendon, on the northwest side of London, and then they planned their conquering of Britain. And I am still so
much in love with Brian Epstein recognised the talents of the Bee Gees. He set up a meeting with Australian music entrepreneur Robert Stigwood.
Robert Stigwood was really influential on the early Bee Gees career. He was turned onto them by Brian Epstein. He'd heard a demo, and he was the one who kind of made sure that they were on the right career path.
They rolled up at Robert Stigwood's house, they played him some songs, they sang some harmonies, and that very day, he signed them to a 5-year deal.
Robert Stigwood took on the Bee Gees almost as his own Beatles. And then he was very instrumental. You know, he'd been working with the Beatles, biggest band in the world, and he'd seen what, you know, how they got big and what was possible. And he also saw that they weren't playing live. And so the Bee Gees were a little bit more malleable.
Proclaiming that the Bee Gees were the most significant new talent of 1967, Robert Stigwood knew the band could be a worldwide success and set about promoting their unique sound, leading to their UK breakthrough single, New York Mining Disaster, 1941.
New York Mining Disaster 1941 was loosely based around the Abervan mining disaster of 1966. There wasn't actually a New York mining disaster in 1941. And they recorded it and did those weird, strange harmonies in the corridor of Polydor just to get that extra echo. Thinking those who once existed must be dead. Because the Bee Gees were quite unknown in Britain at the time. And because the Beatles weren't putting out too many records in that particular month, their record company thought it would be a fantastic idea to send New York Mining Disaster 1941 to radio stations without actually mentioning who was singing the song.
A lot of radio DJs assumed that it was a new Beatles record and therefore put it on heavy rotation. Now, this got them a lot of airplay, and it just shows the difference in the sound compared to what they had later.
It gave them instant radio success without them having to really kind of explain who they were.
Or have they given up and all gone home to bed? Thinking those who once existed must be dead.
He managed to pass them off with a certain suggestion without actually ever saying they were the Beatles. There was the inference that the Beatles were there, which, of course, is, if anybody saw them, could work out very quickly that they're nothing of the sort.
It's a great song, but it's very stripped back. It's not the kind of disco Bee Gees that we'd know now. You can certainly hear their vocals, though. Those distinctive vocals and the harmonies are there.
Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide.
Why do we remember the Beatles song so much? It's because of melody. And the Bee Gees had that too, which a lot of rock bands didn't, or you know, the sort of burgeoning bands didn't. It was blues-based, not so much melody, but they're always melody first.
I think you can hear really strongly that they're influenced by bands who had a real good sense of melodies. Also harmony, vocal groups, so people like the Hollies, Everly Brothers. I think you could also hear a bit of like rock and roll in there, so a bit of Elvis, a bit of Rolling Stones. And there's a soul element too that I think you can certainly hear in Robin's voice, which potentially from Otis Redding, something like that.
There is something I would like you all to see.
In 1967, the Bee Gees released their debut international album, Bee Gees First. This included Holiday and To Love Somebody. Drawing comparisons with the Beatles, it wasn't long before the Bee Gees would see widespread success with their second album, Horizontal. In 1968, Massachusetts secured their first number one single in both the UK and Australia.
And the lights all went down in Massachusetts the day.
It propelled the band onto the international stage and would eventually go on to become one of the best-selling singles of all time. Despite never having been to Massachusetts before writing the song, the Bee Gees turned their attentions to America.
Because Stigwood was a friend of Brian Epstein and he'd seen what had happened with the Beatles, he thought that this could be repeated. And naturally, in America, in the late 60s, there was this huge demand for anything British, and if they happened to sound a little bit like the Beatles, so much the better. So, of course, the Bee Gees, under Stigwood's guidance, trooped over to America. They signed to Atlantic Records, and suddenly they started having hits.
America basically reacted instantly to the Bee Gees. They got on very, very well. They had a top 20 hit as soon as they went over there, and it just felt quite spontaneous, really.
I think the Bee Gees did really well initially in America off the back of Beatlemania and that kind of England appeal at that time in the States. And for them, it was a really successful period for them.
There were warnings given to the LAPD when the Bee Gees went over in 1968, warning them about a Beatlemania-esque reaction. That's how popular they were considered to be.
They were also very presentable. You know, so they're on the Ed Sullivan Show, they're on the Lucille Ball Show, which at that point was the way in which you're going to get into mainstream America. And it worked.
Massachusetts is one place I have seen.
The Bee Gees were now enjoying huge international acclaim with sellout tours around the world. Further chart singles followed from the band's next album, Idea, including I've Gotta Get a Message to You, their second UK number one. Despite their continued success, it wasn't without its impact on the band, as lead guitarist Vince Maloney left the group.
Said, come and walk with me.
Further cracks appeared when Robin Gibb collapsed with nervous exhaustion in August 1968. Forcing the postponement of their seven-week American tour. By March the following year, he had left the band.
I just gotta get a message to you. Hold on, hold on.
One of the lesser-known aspects of the Bee Gees was, although they were brothers and they had this huge filial bond, that they didn't always get on. There's always, throughout their entire career, being a lot of friction between Barry and Robin.
Robin began to feel that Robert Stigwood was favouring Barry, and I think possibly he was beginning to feel that his own efforts weren't being appreciated enough, and he was frustrated.
Robin had sung lead on Massachusetts and several other songs. He didn't have the matinee idol looks that Barry had. And the Americans were very keen to promote Barry as the lead Bee Gee.
Ultimately, he was frustrated with the fact that Robert Stigwood was pushing Barry up there as the frontman for the group. Also, he didn't agree with some of the creative decisions being made in terms of single releases.
There was an album called Odessa, which was a progressive concept album, but at the time it was all about progressive rock albums, and this was almost a sort of progressive symphonic pop album, which is something different. A great album. Robin felt very, very frustrated. You know, this really was Barry's vision, and Robert Stigwood supported it wholeheartedly, so he left in a bit of a huff.
Following the departure of Robin Gibb to pursue a solo career, the band recruited Sister Leslie with minimal chart success, culminating in Morris and Barry parting ways. Despite some negative public comments voiced by the band, it had become clear to them that each played a significant part in the makeup of the Bee Gees.
The Bee Gees always described themselves as a tripod, and that if one leg of this tripod went, the whole thing would topple over. Barry, effectively, was the dominant personality, and he was mainly responsible for the melodies. Robin, who was always much more wordy, was mainly responsible for the lyrics. And this left Morris, who was probably the best instrumentalist in the Bee Gees, but he very much enjoyed a drink for a long period. So he was often out of the creative loop, but because he was such a gregarious, genial sort of guy, he was also the person who kept the warring, sparring alpha males that were Barry and Robin together. So his role was just as important, and they always acknowledged that this was roughly how it worked.
I can think of younger days when living for my life was everything a man could want to do.
In August 1970, the Bee Gees reformed and achieved chart success with Lonely Days, as well as a first US number one and Grammy nomination for How Can You Mend a Broken Heart.
How can you stop the rain from falling down? How can you stop the sun from shining? What makes the world go round?
Just as quickly as the Bee Gees had become popular, then they faded. It was, and of course still is, a very fickle business. And a year and a half after he left, Robin returned. But unfortunately, this wasn't the catalyst to greater things. His solo career hadn't been all overly successful, but the Bee Gees' moment had passed too. And so when he returned, he came back to a group who were in artistic and commercial doldrums.
I can still feel the breeze that rustles through the trees.
And they had a massive hit with How Can You Mend a Broken Heart, which is one of those songs we all know. But then they had this period with an album called Life in a Tin Can, and then they had another album which never even came out. That just got canned. So they were sort of thinking, well, maybe this is it. You know, we're now talking 72, 73, and they thought, we've had a good run, you know. This is this. And in the 60s, bands lasted a few years, you know, and that was that.
started playing lots of small clubs in England, just felt like they lost their way a little bit. Musically, I think they were directionless, they weren't sure where to go next. You know, they've basically morphed by the fact that, you know, the Beatles aren't there anymore, and I think they're looking for something new and looking to experiment.
It's been going so badly for the Bee Gees that they'd found themselves almost on the nostalgia circuit in Britain. And they were playing places like Batley Variety Club, where Morris met his second wife. And they realised that they were just completely out of step with the times in England.
Please help me mend my broken heart and let me live again.
The Bee Gees knew they needed a change in direction and began searching for a new sound.
They moved to Florida at the advice of Eric Clapton.
They were very good musicians and very good studios in Miami. And that began the incredible creative rebirth which led to the Bee Gees that we all know.
Because they were so close as brothers, they would live almost next door to each other. But in their first period in Florida, they stayed at Eric Clapton's house and they wrote songs, including Jive Talking.
Jive Talking is a great song, a disco track, absolutely classic. You still hear it now and it sounds really, really fresh.
This is the point where Barry starts using that trademark falsetto as well, and you start to hear that much more disco vibe come into their songs, and it was a real change of direction and one for the better as well.
Jive Talking was based around Morris's infatuation with this new instrument called a synth bass, which meant that he could play the bass a little bit like a synthesizer. And he got this syncopated disco dance pattern. And then they added it to Barry's falsetto vocals. And you had this new type of sound. And Barry said that this was very much a conscious decision for them to make. One, because they were being produced by Arif Mardin, who was a dance producer. Two, because they weren't getting anywhere with their old stuff. And three, he suggested that the whole disco movement was a reaction to what had happened in Vietnam, and that people just wanted to dance.
They also had a lot of influence with the people around them at that time and started bringing more kind of soul and disco and funk sound into their music, which of course we now know that then kind of was the next stage of the Bee Gees sound.
They decided to be brave and experiment with sound. I think going to another country for a musician can open up a whole world of possibilities. You start listening to other things. They weren't as restricted as in England, which perhaps had a sort of less broad musical genres at that point. So going to America really opened things up for them musically.
The mid-1970s saw a new style of music from the Bee Gees. This disco sound, combined with Barry Gibb's falsetto vocals, saw a positive response from fans. However, it was to be their soundtrack to the film Saturday Night Fever that would see them explode onto the disco scene.
Saturday Night Fever came from this pulp novel by Nick Cohn. Robert Stigwood was producing the film of it.
It had a very low budget. They weren't stars. There was no soundtrack. No studio wanted it.
Various other people had been tried. John Travolta remembers in the rehearsals dancing to almost anything apart from the Bee Gees. And Robert Stigwood, always a man with an eye for an opportunity for his boys, remembered that the Bee Gees had these two fairly recent songs, Jive Talkin' and You Should Be Dancing. Gave them a call, said, anything else along those lines? And they were producing an album at the time, and they said yes. Although, of course, the truthful answer was no.
He thought they already would have those songs written, and they said they did, they didn't, but they just went away and knocked together a soundtrack, which has become one of the most iconic, culturally important soundtracks of our time.
They were written in France, in a chateau, over a week or so, all around the kitchen table, apparently, and they sat there with notebooks and said, what have you got?
They produced it incredibly, incredibly quickly, which is astonishing. If you think about the longevity that the songs have had since, it's amazing that they were able to come up with so much material so quickly.
The film itself, although low budget, was a huge success. It captured the moment where the underground dance music of disco went overground, and you couldn't get any more overground than Saturday Night Fever.
John Travolta in that lead role is absolutely iconic. It was something revolutionary in terms of cinema, but also in terms of the soundtrack. It's a great example of people really buying into a film because the music resonates with them so much, and that's down to the Bee Gees.
The soundtrack broke multiple industry records, becoming the highest-selling album in recording history, and is still one of the most successful albums of all time.
Everyone who heard the songs wanted to see the film, and everyone who saw the film wanted to then listen to the songs again. And in that way, it's a really important moment, I think, for both film and for music.
It catapulted the Bee Gees into a whole new world. Although it was very much a story of a Brooklyn boy, it took this dance music into middle America. So you had people in Poughkeepsie and St. Louis and Kansas buying dance records, and that had never happened before.
Staying Alive is such an iconic disco song. Even though it comes quite late in the disco era, it's when you think of the Bee Gees and when you think of that film, it's just, like, culturally a really important moment in music and film. It's definitely up there with one of the best Bee Gees songs. Well, you can't tell.
There's something kind of incredible about it. I think it's a very unusual song because although it is a dance song on the face of it, it's kind of got the strange sort of energy, which is, it's almost like a rock song.
Listening to it without the visuals, they're using the words of black culture, and they're turning them into something that is incredibly seductive for both white and black culture.
What's quite funny is when you then watch the video, which is really separate from what you imagine from the film. It's got that kind of like 70s feel to it because it's obviously them dressed in their flares and tight shirts, but they're kind of walking through this abandoned town situation that doesn't like really connect to the film.
There's these three impossibly tight trousered white men camping it up. When they're doing the ha 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 bit, it all goes to different windows and they're gurning through these windows.
Having won 5 Grammy Awards for Saturday Night Fever, the Bee Gees were a worldwide sensation. For the first time since the Beatles, March 1978 saw the Bee Gees occupy the 2 top positions on the US charts with Night Fever and Stayin' Alive.
After Saturday Night Fever, the Bee Gees continued to have this purple patch, 6 number ones in a row, which is quite incredible.
How do you follow Saturday Night Fever? I mean, what a huge success. They had more success. They followed it with Tragedy.
My favourite Bee Gees song is Tragedy. Listen to how it builds and the sense of drama. It's marvellous.
The Bee Gees were so associated with what we think of as the disco movement that when people got fed up with disco and everyone was going on about disco sucks, of course, the Bee Gees were Public Enemy number one, and you start having radio DJs in America who promised Bee Gee-free weekends. You know, it wasn't that people didn't like the Bee Gees, it was that they were sick of them. You know, there would have been a period when you could not have walked down the street without hearing Staying Alive or Tragedy or, you know, How Deep Is Your Love, one of these songs which are just everywhere.
The more successful they became with Saturday Night Fever, they succumbed to the usual rock and roll temptations. And again, there was increasing friction between Barry and Robin. They had 3 American number one singles off the follow-up album, Spirits Having Flown. So they were hardly on their uppers, but you could see what was going to happen in the immediate future.
Quite clever, they decided to write for other people. Smart way of, you know, still getting your music out there, still making money, still working.
They're writing tracks like Emotion, Grease, which Frankie Valli obviously then went on to do, and started working with people like Dionne Warwick, Dolly Parton, Diana Ross.
They didn't go with unknowns, they went with a famous people who were in need of a bit of Bee Gees.
They wrote fantastic songs, this Island in the Stream for Dolly Parton and Kenny Rogers.
It's amazing when you look at the list of songs and absolutely huge hits that they worked on that you might not realise the Gibb brothers were behind.
They were just using the songwriting talents which they'd shown so long ago in Australia and applying them to other people again.
But also their youngest brother as well grew up to become a musician. Think of the sounds that they created. It's not just Bee Gees records, it's sounds of that entire era that they're responsible for. Why do you have to be a
heartbreaker? After working on various projects throughout the 1980s, it wasn't until 1987 when the Bee Gees released their own new material with the album ESP. Selling over 3 million copies, it was their first album for 6 years and their first for Warner Brothers Records.
You and Again, I think, was the last really great Bee Gees song. I mean, bafflingly, and I don't know how this happened, it wasn't really a big hit in America at all, but it was a number one in Britain and in most other territories that they released it.
I remember seeing it on TV and thinking, wow, they've really gone with the 80s. I mean, Barry had a ponytail, they had a model jumping about, you know, everybody had to have a model in their videos in the 80s. And they had this kind of horrible tinny synthetic beat, which again, everybody had to have in the 80s.
And part of the reason that it was so great was this drum sound. This was Morris's idea, that he recorded this stomping percussion where they were just effectively hitting pots and pans in his garage.
when I hear it now, I still think it's a great song. It's so beautiful, so kind of soaring. There's that kind of like drum beat. And I think it proved that there was life in them still, and they were great songwriters. They weren't just a disco band.
The record company, who, lest we forget, had hardly distinguished themselves by promoting the Bee Gees, they were dead set against having effectively a drum-led song as a single. But the Bee Gees stood their ground, as they often did, and they were right.
You Win Again has been described as one of the best Bee Gees songs ever. It's very iconic now and has been held up as a, you know, an example of songwriting that's one of the best from the last kind of 50 years.
The Bee Gees continued to enjoy much success throughout the 90s, with particular achievements in Europe. They returned to the Polydor label and released the albums Size Isn't Everything and Still Waters. In 1997, they received the Brit Award for Outstanding Contribution to Music and continued to sell out tours around the world.
The Bee Gees live, it was always a difficult proposition because naturally they had to have a band and their shows were very lavish, they were very slick, and there were certain songs which the crowd wanted to hear and others which the Bee Gees wanted to play, and those interests didn't always coincide. But they knew how to put a good show on. They'd been doing it since they were tots. The last few tours that they did were hugely enjoyable for them. They saw firsthand that they were really loved and they weren't derided. So all the bad things that had happened to them in the early 70s, when no one bought their records, and after Saturday Night Fever, when they were derided and mocked constantly, they were just blips, and they understood this. So the last shows were huge and they were celebratory affairs.
The 2001 release of This Is Where I Came In was to be their final album. A combination of solo work and the sudden death of Maurice Gibb in 2003 was to signal the end of the Bee Gees as the world knew them and their decades of global hits.
I've seen the story, I read it over once or twice. I said that you say a little bit of bad advice.
In 2003, Maurice Gibb died, and it was quite a shock. He was very young, and of course, the band at that point, they had live dates lined up and they said they were going to carry on in his memory. But quite quickly, I think it became apparent to them that that wasn't going to work. So Barry and Robin said, that's it, we're not going to carry on with the Bee Gees' name anymore.
When Maurice died, it wasn't the Bee Gees anymore. I mean, the Bee Gees is about those three personalities, those three brothers, those beautiful voices working in harmony together. Maurice was perhaps not the kind of known for the songwriting or known for his distinctive vocals. The vocals were Robin, and the songwriting was Barry for me. But Maurice did all the arrangements, all the kind of vocal harmonies, was the real kind of technical guy, played multi, you know, was a multi-instrumentalist. So without him, you couldn't have the Bee Gees.
Go anywhere. Yes, I'll go anywhere with you. This is the danger zone. This is where I came in.
They were the two who'd never really got on, and that Maurice was the brother who bound them together. And they made the decision to stop. It was that theory about a tripod. One leg of the tripod had been removed, therefore the tripod fell over.
Obviously, they were known as a triumvirate. There was three of them, but also the initials had come to stand for the brothers Gibb. And with one of them not there anymore, it changes the whole dynamic. And I think as a sign of respect, it absolutely was the right thing to do.
The Gibb brothers continued to work independently and record with other artists. They briefly reformed and appeared on television shows in America and the UK, but did not release any new material. Barry Gibb became the last surviving brother after the death of Robin in 2012 and the end of more than 50 years of the Bee Gees.
The Bee Gees have sold literally hundreds of millions of records, and they haven't had the respect and acclaim that they really deserve. Partially that's because of how they looked, a little bit because of how Barry sounded with his falsetto, and a little bit too because they're champions of disco, which has never quite escaped the aura of NAFF that surrounds it. But just listen to these songs over all this time, and there's so much great stuff in there.
Five decades worth of songwriting and an ability to adapt and keep creating, to keep making music that's fresh.
They've influenced a whole lot of people, from Michael Jackson, you know, to Beyonce, people that you wouldn't expect, actually. The voices were great, but for me, it's about the songwriting. I think that's the greatest legacy of the Bee Gees.
What tends to happen with music is that the image fades away, but the music, especially fantastic songs that people love, just keep going. So I think their legacy will be as very much classic songwriters.
It's an incredible collection of work, and in terms of kind of culturally being really important at different points through the last few decades, the Bee Gees had impact in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s and the 90s, and that's really rare. And I think, you know, in that way, their legacy is going to last for a long time. Thank you.